First of all, good morning, and thank you for coming. Before I start, I want to mention something that Bill has mentioned and that others of you, I think, will resonate to, and that is each of us, most of us at Williams, have had a professor or two who made a difference, who made a significant impact in our lives. I certainly had one. His name was Kurt Tauber, and he's here today. And Kurt, I just want to salute you and say thank you. So the question is, what does the class of 1964 have to do with the First World War? And the answer is nothing. But 2014 is our 50th anniversary of graduation, but it's also the 100th anniversary of the start of the Great War. And so it seems appropriate to take a quick look at this cataclysmic event when Europe went mad. There are lots of things to keep in mind about the First World War, lots of things to remember. In 1914, Europe went mad. The Great War lasted 1,568 days. More than 8.1 million soldiers were killed. Several million civilians were killed. I mean, it was mass idiocy, and it was bloodshed on an unparalleled level. America enters the war, as you know, in 1917, late to the party. And most Americans think that they won the First World War. A better way of saying it is that America's entry into the battlefield enabled the French and the British to win the First World War. If Williams had geography when we were there, I think I would have majored in geography. I love maps. Look at Germany. Notice that to its west is France, its age-old enemy. And France is seeking revenge because in 1871, at the end of the Franco-Prussian War, the Germans take control of two French provinces, Alsace and Lorraine, and the French are eager to get them back. Germany looks to the east and it sees Russia, whom they consider a bunch of primitives. Lots of manpower, not a lot of talent. Germany thinks of itself as a shield against the masses of Russia and as a protector, not just of German culture, but of European civilization. Germany looks to the northwest, to the North Sea, and it sees the British Navy sailing around the North Sea. So Germany feels it is surrounded and is surrounded. Notice just by way of looking at maps that there are lots of poles in 1914, but there's no Poland, okay? And Germany, East Prussia of Germany, extends way to the east. So Germany's surrounded, anxious about its enemies, fearful of its future. So it devises a military plan in the case of war to handle its situation. And the plan is drawn up by this fellow, who's the chief of the General Imperial Staff, Alfred Schlieffen. And his idea is that you take one army and you stick it to the east and hold off the Russians, because the Russians are incompetent, and it'll take them 4 or 5 weeks to get their act together. Concentrate the bulk of your military force in the west and strike hard at France. Defeat, crush the French in 40 days. Put them out of the picture. Take your very efficient railroad system. Take the troops that have defeated the French, move them to the east, and confront the Russians. So it's the Schlieffen plan. And in chapter one or chapter two of every book on World War I you will read about the Schlieffen plan, and you'll see a picture of the general. Germany at the turn of the century and at 1914 is a prosperous state. It's an economic powerhouse. It produces more steel than the Brits. It has a progressive society. They have health insurance for their workers. It has a parliament, a Reichstag, that matters because it controls the budget. And it's really quite a modern progressive state, but there are two hiccups. Hiccup number one is that the army has an undue influence in the political world. And hiccup number two is that this idiot on the left is the commander-in-chief and the Kaiser, the emperor of the German Republic, of the German imperial state. And he is intellectually lazy. He's proof positive of why you do not want monarchy as your form of government, okay? This is a map of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which is allied with Germany, one of their few friends. Just notice that Trieste is not part of Italy, okay? And that Galicia and the Carpathian Mountains are right here. This is a ramshackle affair. It's in its dying days. It is full of nationalities. The army speaks 10 or 11 different languages. And it's on its last leg. One of the German generals during the war, in speaking about the Austrians, said that Germany was shackled to a corpse. The dual monarchies is run by the emperor, who's an elderly fellow and conservative in the extreme. The heir apparent is an archduke, the fellow on the right, who by Austrian standards is a liberal, but is in fact a fairly conservative fellow, except for one thing. He realizes the nationalities that comprise the Austrian-Hungarian Empire need to have their own political semi-independence. And he has a plan to remake the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. Unfortunately, he decides to take a trip in June of 1914. And he goes to Sarajevo, part of the capital of Bosnia, which has recently been annexed by the empire. In Bosnia, there are a whole bunch of Serbians. Serbian is the country to the south. The Serbians and the Austrians detest each other. And so on June 28th, with his lovely wife, Sophie, that's Sophie, it's their wedding anniversary. And they are making a state visit to Sarajevo. And a Serbian nationalist, 19-year-old kid, pulls the trigger twice and assassinates the Archduke. I mean, we all know this, right? He assassinates the Archduke and he kills Sophie. And so a whole bunch of things happen because of alliances and commitments. I tried to get some images of dominoes falling down and was unable to do so, but roughly what happens is Austria declares war on Serbia. Russia considers itself the protector of Serbia for reasons of race and religion. So the Tsar mobilizes the Russian army, which frightens the Germans, who then mobilize their army, which frightens the French, who then mobilize their army. When the German army mobilizes, it is, in fact, going to war, because there's really no administrative mechanisms to call it off. So the key in all of these dominoes is when the Russian army mobilizes, forces the German to mobilize. Everybody expects that the war is going to be short, but he who attacks first is going to win. So on August 1st, 1914, Germany declares war on Russia, and 2 days later declares war on France. It being the 100th anniversary, there is a tidal wave of books about the First World War. And these are two of the better ones. And the one on the right is one that I recommend to all of you. The author is Margaret McMillan. She teaches at a college in England. I think it's called Cambridge. It's really very, very good. And it's a wonderful explanation of how the First World War came to be and what were the steps that led up to it. So Schlesien's has retired, and there's another general in charge. Germany decides to hit France, and hit France hard. Again, 40 days, wipe out the French, make the western borders secure, move the troops to the east to deal with the hated Russians. Germany has 8 armies. One of them, the 8th, they stick in the east to keep track of the Russians. They take 7, put them in the west. 2 of them go to Alsace and Lorraine because the Germans know the French are going to attack. 5 armies are left for the attack into France. The top 3 armies, the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, are the sharp end of the spear. They number 760,000 men. This is no small endeavor. Notice, though, that the plan takes the German army through Belgium, okay? Belgium is this still small country. There's been a treaty that guarantees the independence and the integrity of Belgium, which Germany and France and, you know, everybody has signed, including the Brits. The Brits take it seriously, however. Germany had hoped that Germany had hoped that they would call up the king of Belgium and say, look, we're going to move several hundred thousand troops through your country into France, but not to worry. When it's over, we'll move them out, and we'd like free passage. I'm not making this up. And the Belgians said, I don't think so, and they fought, and they tied up a number of German divisions that otherwise would have been fighting against the French. Britain honors its treaty to Belgium. So this is why Britain gets involved in the Great War, because Germany has invaded Belgium, violated the treaty that everybody signed, and so John Bull enters the fray. It's a little dark, but the British have a very large navy. They have a very small army. The British Expeditionary Force that goes to France is 125,000 men. But it's a professional army. And they are very good marksmen. And so at the first European battle the British Army has fought in 100 years, at a town called Mons, they take on the Germans. They have to withdraw because they're overwhelmed in numbers, but they take a frightful toll of the German attackers. So the Germans march through Belgium, and they're coming down into France, and they get real close to Paris, and they get to the Marne River. 25 miles from Paris. And basically, the French army holds with help from the Belgians and help from the Brits. And the great battle is the Battle of the Marne. The French stop the Germans. The Germans retreat and start to dig and build a trench, which is the beginning. The reason there are taxicabs in the image is that there are French troops in Paris which need to be transported to the battlefield, but the French army doesn't have enough trucks and wagons and mules to handle them, so the garrison commander takes over all the taxis. They were Renault taxis. There are about 500, 550 of them, and you could get six or seven French soldiers in each taxi, and off they go to war. And it is now part of the legend of Paris and of the French army, the Renault taxicabs of the Battle of the Marne. When the battle was over, bells rang out throughout France because the country had been saved from the hated Hun. While the French are attacking through Belgium and France, the French army, ever anxious to retrieve Alsace and Lorraine, attacks along their mutual border north of Switzerland, right? Initially, they do very well, but in the near term, they do well, but in fact, the Germans counterattacked and whipped the French. And so in a series of battles that are known as the Battle of the Frontiers, French have 200,000 casualties. And that has nothing to do with the main strike force of the Germans and the Battle of the Marne. So the Germans retreat 20, 25 miles and start to dig. And then each army tries to outflank the other, right? So that they end up at the English Channel in Belgium, having built trenches all along the way. And that's when and how the noted trench warfare of the First World War begins. And it's about 425 miles of trenches from the English Channel all the way down to Switzerland. In the East, meanwhile, the Russians have surprised everyone, and they've mobilized faster than anticipated. And two Russian armies attack East Prussia. The Germans, remember, have one of their eight armies to confront them, and confront them they do, and they beat the Russians. One of the Russian armies is completely destroyed, and the Germans take 92,000 prisoners. A series of battles were given the name of Tannenberg by the Germans. The German commander of one of the army is so disgraced and upset that he walks out into the forest, puts a gun to his head, and blows his brains out. Tannenberg becomes the great German victory. And the two generals in charge of the great victory are propelled to prominence, Hindenburg and Ludendorff. Ludendorff is the operational guy. Hindenburg is the guy at the top. And one historian said that Hindenburg spent the rest of the war getting his portrait painted. But they become the commanders of the entire East. Later, they become commanders of the entire army. And by 1917, the German army is actually running the government. The Austrians, the corps. The Austrians start the war by attacking Serbia and do extremely poorly. Then they attack the Russians and do extremely poorly. And by the end of 1914, 5 months, just in 5 months, they've had over 1 million casualties, the Austrians. It's just extraordinary. A painting and a picture of Austrian soldiers. They were not lacking in courage. They were lacking in generals who knew what they were doing. When they attacked Serbia, remember I mentioned that the Austrians and the Serbians detest each other. This is a photograph of the Austrians dealing with some of their Serb adversaries. And I could just as easily say that it's Serbians shooting Austrians, because they went after each other with a vengeance. So at the end of 5 months, the end of 1914, you have 607,000 soldiers killed, not wounded, killed in 5 months of the first year. And that total doesn't include the Russians and doesn't include the Austrians. So the bloodbath has begun, and Europe indeed has gone mad. Now, I'm going to blitz through 1915. Lots of things happened. The Austrians, for example, attacked the Russians in January, February, and March of 1915. The problem is, it's wintertime, they attack in the mountains, they don't have enough ammunition, they don't have enough warm clothes, they don't have enough boots, and they have generals who don't know what the hell they're doing. So in 3 months, they lose another 800,000 men. Ypres, which I undoubtedly mispronounce, is a town in Flanders. In the first battle of Ypres, where the line is extended in 1914, the Germans employ about 25,000 youngsters from universities who are all keen to go and kill the enemy. And they are slaughtered by the British. And it's known as, my German is non-existent, it's known as the Kindermord. 25,000 youngsters, 18, 19-year-olds, are killed. And there is an arch in one of the German military cemeteries that have the insignia of the 25 universities where these kids were killed in the first battle of Ypres. The second battle takes place in early 1915 and is notable because that's when gas is introduced. The Germans employ chlorine gas, and it gets blown in the right way, and all of a sudden there are a whole bunch of British troops who are coughing and having trouble breathing. There is actually a third battle of Ypres, which is a bloodbath where the amount of blood is only equaled by the amount of mud, but that doesn't happen until 1917. This is the town. It was a beautiful medieval town, and it's leveled by the Germans. This, of course, is an early gas mass. About 1.3 million soldiers were either wounded or killed by gas during the First World War. It was, of course, a horrible experience, but then so was getting cut down by a machine gun or blown apart by an artillery shell. In 1915, the Italians joined the war. And in a somewhat calculated decision, they decide to go with the French and the British, in part because they think the French and the British are going to win. The other part is that they can't stand the Austrians, with whom they share a border. And they figure, we join the French and British, the French and the British win, we'll get a piece of Austria at the end, which is exactly what happens. So now, as you all know, Trieste is no longer part of Austria, it's part of Italy. If you were a German soldier and you wanted to have a general who knew what he was doing, this is the fellow, okay? He commands an army in the east, and in 1915, he crushes the Russians. He just crushes the Russians. And takes 140,000 Russian prisoners. Now, I think the only thing worse than being a German prisoner of the Russians, I never get this right, would be a Russian prisoner. One of them, they're both terrible. One's worse than the other. In any case, I don't know what you, I know, I can comprehend 14 prisoners. I can comprehend 140 prisoners, I can probably comprehend 1,400 prisoners. You know, you build a camp and you feed them and you do all, keep guards and you have German shepherds and you do all this sort of stuff. I honestly can't comprehend 140,000 prisoners. I mean, you gotta feed them, you gotta move them around, you gotta guard them. I mean, it's just, one of the interesting things about the First World War is its scale and the numbers of people involved. And there's no better example of that scale than that caption right there. Meanwhile, the Austrians are fighting the Russians in the Carpathian Mountains. I never knew the Carpathian Mountains existed until I started to read all this stuff, so I looked it up. It turns out the Carpathian Mountains is a mountain chain of 1,400 miles, and they now encompass Slovakia, Poland, Ukraine, and Romania. I mean, who knew, right? And And there were extensive battles between the Austrians and the Russians, and then the Germans and the Austrians and the Russians. But at the same time, the Brits and the Ottomans, the Turks, are fighting in Palestine and Mesopotamia, right? And at one time, a British force of 12,000 is defeated at a town south of Baghdad. And most of the prisoners of the Turks eventually do not make it home alive. The great event, or one great event of 1915 is, with the stalemate on the Western Front, with the Germans running wild in the East, a number of Brits decide, one of whom is Winston Churchill, who's the first Lord of the Admiralty, which is the civilian head of the Navy, decide, listen, we're not making any headway against the Germans in the trenches, so why don't we take some soldiers in the Navy and go up the Dardanelles, knock off the Turks, take charge of Constantinople, and we'll have the Black Sea to ourselves, and we can easily aid our friends, the Russians. Makes perfectly good strategic sense. The problem was that they first tried just with their Navy, and they go steaming into the Dardanelles, and the Turks, not being stupid, have put artillery guns on both sides of the straits and mined the waters, and so three battleships get sunk. And the Royal Navy says, geez, there's got to be a better way to do this. So they then land 10 or 15,000 troops on the west side. And these troops are mostly the Australians and the New Zealanders. And they take on the Turks, and the Turks are well fortified. They are well led. They're tough. And the Australians and the New Zealanders make no progress, lose a great many to death and to disease. And when they evacuate the Dardanelles in December, no one in Britain or in British or French military circles think the thing was other than a complete disaster, which it was. And Churchill then has to resign and is no longer First Lord of the Admiralty. 1915, in addition to a huge loss of life, told the generals that the war was not going to be a short war, which in 1914 they all thought it would be. It's hard to imagine after the slaughter of 1914 and 1915 that things could get worse. But they do. Verdun. Verdun is a town in France that's, I don't know, 100 miles, 80 miles northwest of Paris. And it's a town, and it's well fortified by French fortresses. German general says, we're concentrating on the east. We're making progress in the east. But I need to attack the French or the British. So I'm going to attack the French, and I'm going to pick a spot where I know they will defend, and I will bleed the French army to death. Right? And this is the fellow who decides to do that. And so the standard interpretation of the Battle of Verdun, which is the longest battle in the First World War, from February to December, the standard interpretation was that Falkenhayn decided to do this, bleed the French army to death, and writes this memo to this effect. Problem turns out that the memo is only in his memoirs, which he writes in 1920. And at the time, no one can find the memo. One excuse is, well, that's because all the German army records of World War I were blown to smithereens in World War II. True, they were. But none of his senior subordinates recall this memo. So it is now beginning to believe that he made it all up, because not only did the French army get crucified at Verdun, so did the German army. Next one. I get out of the way. 976,000 soldiers were casualties at the Battle of Verdun. And Verdun, during and after the war, during the battle, it becomes a symbolic battle whose value is greater than its strategic or tactical sense. It becomes a question of will. French aren't going to throw in the towel. Germans are pounding away. And for France, particularly in the years after the war, Verdun starts to hold an almost mystical image in the minds of the French. Bunch of forts. So that's the French. It's 1916. Germans have attacked the French at Verdun. The British are planning a major assault themselves at the Somme. And so they attack on the first day of July. On the first day of July in 1916, 19,240 British soldiers were killed in one day. Not wounded, a whole bunch more wounded. The number really bears repeating. 19,240 were killed on day one. 19,000 were killed on day one. It was a slaughter, and it continues through November. And there are the bloody numbers. There is an interpretation with some merit that despite the loss and despite the minor grounds gained, it was a victory for the British because between it and Verdun, the German army was bleeding profusely. And the war of attrition, which is what the war had become in the West, was beginning to favor the Allies. Meanwhile, I mean, when you read about the First World War and you're reading about the Western Front, there's always something else going on somewhere else. Romania, encouraged by some initial Russian successes, says, gee, these guys are going to win. Let's sign up on their side, which they do. Turns out, in the short term, not to have been a good decision. Germans don't take kindly to it, so a Bulgarian and an Austrian and German combined army invade Romania and take control of it. Romania has oil and it has grain, and both of those are needed for the German war machine. I laugh, and I once said to my wife, Joyce, that she probably had never seen a picture of Bulgarian generals, and I suspect the same is true of you all. So there. And yet, you know, at our age, virgin experiences are rare. there's a photograph of Bulgarian generals. Now, the image that we have of the First World War is that it was trenches and these guys with funny helmets and a lot of mud. And that is, of course, an image, not the image, but an image of the war. There was also a war at sea, and it was very, very important. In those days, back then, all the European countries had outposts, colonies on the coast of China. Germany had one. And because it had an outpost, it needed a squadron of vessels, cruisers like that, to show the flag as they sailed around and had parties with each other and occasionally shot up some Chinese. The war begins. The Japanese, who have their eye on China, with British help, invade the Chinese colony and take control of it. The German squadron, the East Asia squadron, if I knew German, I would know how to say that. It sails away and it says, we've got to get home. So it sends one of its vessels into the Indian Ocean to create mayhem, which it does. But it takes the rest of the squadron, three cruisers and a couple of oilers and destroyers, and they head out across the Pacific to Chile, where they are encountered by a British squadron sailing around the Cape of Good Hope, right? Good Hope? Yeah. Up north, and there is a major sea battle in the First World War off the coast of Chile, in which the Germans, who have better ships than the British, sink the two British cruisers and kill 1,400 sailors. Okay? It's called the Battle of Coronel. And if you look at a map of Chile, you go north of San Diego, there's this little town called Coronel, and right then and there is when the two squadrons met, and the Germans are triumphant. British do not take kindly to this, and they send several battle cruisers down to the Falklands. This is HMS Invincible, and the two photographs at the top are, I think, remarkable images because they are Invincible and Inflexible steaming into battle against the Germans who have come back and to the Falklands. So off the Falkland Islands, remember this is not 1982, this is the first Battle of the Falklands, the two British battle cruisers take on the German squadrons and sink them, and all the sailors are lost. This is a great image because, all right, this is the smoke from the engines. That forward bunch of smoke is because these guns have just fired. So these are really two remarkable photographs. A couple other things happen, but we'll skip forward. The British want to have a great sea battle with the Germans. Germany has a high seas fleet, which is very good, excellent optics, great officer corps, great design ships. And the question is if and when the two fleets will collide. And they do collide at the end of May in 1916. And the British are hoping for a decisive victory, much like Admiral Nelson had in 1805 at Trafalgar. But just to give you an idea of, the scale of this endeavor, the British fleet has 28 battleships. Each with about 1,000 crew, steaming towards the end of the day in the gray North Sea, right? The Germans, who are outnumbered, have 99 vessels in this titanic naval engagement, where the Germans do quite well because they sink more ships than they have sunk, and they kill more sailors than they have their sailors killed. But at the end of it, nothing changes. The British still German fleet goes back to port, where it stays for the rest of the war, and the Royal Navy still owns the North Sea. These are two of my favorite images. I think this stuff is really cool. Look at that thing. Okay. That's HMS Iron Duke. Iron Duke, of course, was the informal name given to Wellington. This is the fellow in charge of the British fleet, Sir John Jellicoe, about whom Winston Churchill said, correctly actually, he was the only man who could lose the war in an afternoon. which at Jutland, fortunately for the British, he did not do. The British in their fleet, and you saw Invincible, had a new kind of ship. It was called a battle cruiser, and it was as big as a battleship, and it had guns as big as the guns on a battleship, but it was fast as a cruiser. And so what was missing was it didn't have any armor. And the idea was it would engage cruisers, enemy cruisers could not outrun it, but they could outrun enemy battleships. Makes perfectly good sense unless you put your battle cruisers in the line of battle, which Mr. Jellicoe did, with disastrous results. The commander, the British admiral in charge of the battle cruisers, and it was a squadron, a separate squadron, was David Beatty, and he ends up with, if it's not the classic quote of World War I, it may be one of the classic quotes of all time. He's on his bridge with his binoculars, and he looks around, and he sees Queen Mary, where she's right there, and he looks at it invincible, and he probably says, something's wrong. And so he says this. I have a cheat sheet. I hope none of you can see this, but in gray right here, I have the number of sailors killed on Invincible, and it is 1,020 men were killed when the ship just blew up. And the reason it blew up, because it had no armor, the gun turret is out like this, and there's an elevator, you know, to bring up the ammunition. There's a column there. So a shell hits the gun turret, and the gases from the explosion go right down to the magazine, and the whole ship goes kablooey. And three battle cruisers of the Royal Navy blew up during the Battle of Jutland. Queen Mary had 1,266 sailors lost, and Indefatigable had 1,017. It's just extraordinary, extraordinary. So in our very quick review, what does the Royal Navy do during the First World War? The last bullet, I think, is the most important one, because on day one, the British Navy puts a blockade, a maritime blockade, against Germany. And it's against Germany. Actually, it's also against the Americans who wanted to trade with Germany, but that's a separate story. And so over time, Germany, Berlin, and other places, they do not have enough coal, they do not have enough food, and they do not have enough soap. So they therefore are cold, because they have no coal. They are hungry, because they have no food. And they are dirty, because they have no soap. And it's because of the blockade. And what happens, as you all know, is that in 1918, German civil and political society implodes and just collapses. Historians tend to say, gee, there was no one cause of why Germany lost the war. But there is no cause more important than the blockade put in place on day one by the Royal Navy. Airplanes come of age in the First World War. In 4.5 years of battle, aeronautical technologies are advanced 20, 25 years. And one of the most important tasks conducted by airplanes is reconnaissance. If you're a general and you want to know what you're facing, you got a guy on an airplane, fly over and look down and say, oh, look, there's a whole army there, or there's no army there, or there's a whole bunch of cannons, or there's a whole bunch of this. So reconnaissance becomes a very important part, for the first time, of warfare, both on the Western Front and the Eastern Front. Planes, two crew, the guy in the back has the gun, but he also has eyes and maybe binoculars. And you keep track of what's going on with your foes across the way. And it becomes not only very important, but they become very good at it, both the Germans and the French and the Brits, particularly the Brits. And you put a big deal camera in your plane, and you fly over the enemy lines, and you take photographs of their airfield, like that, so you know what you're confronting, where the enemy is strong, where the enemy is weak. So if you're a general and you see some enemy observation planes flying over, you say, well, that's not good. Let's shoot them down. So you get single-engine planes with machine guns, and their job is to shoot down the observation planes. In those days, they were called pursuit planes. Now we call them fighters. The machine guns fired through the propellers because there was an interrupter gear. So when the propeller is like this, the gun fires. But when the propeller is like this, the gun does not fire, which is good, right? Sopwith is the company name. Camel is the name of the fighter, and it's named that because of this bulge here. This is one of the great fighter planes, pursuit planes of the First World War. It was, as you can see, difficult to fly, but if you mastered it, it was a killing machine. And during the war, according to my cheat sheet right here, it shot down 1,543 enemy aircraft. And the pilots, of course, became heroes. And if you shot down 5 enemy planes, you were an ace, right? And the highest scoring ace of the First World War was him, who shot down 80 aircraft. And he did it in a very cold-blooded way. Here's the enemy plane, and here's the Baron. And he just swooped down like this, get behind him, shoot his guns, kill the pilot, ruin the planes, and fly off. It was not heroic. It was his plane and he were a killing machine, and he had the highest scoring number of kills. The highest scoring American was Eddie Rickenbacker, who, by the way, flew a French plane because the American Army was so under equipped that no American designed planes fought in the First World War. American fighter pilots flew French and some British planes. Those of you who lived and worked on the East Coast in the last 50 years know Eastern Airlines, right? He was one of the founders after the war of Eastern Airlines with 26 victories. Just notice that. Many of the fighter squadrons had insignia, which they would paint on the side of their aircraft. And the first American fighter squadron that went into action in 1918 was this one, the 94th, which was, in fact, Rickenbacker's squadron. And it was the first. So Uncle Sam was in the war, and his hat was in the ring. So hence the insignia on the side of those aircraft. Rickenbacker, of course, was the highest scoring American ace. There's another American ace whom we don't know a lot about. We know he was an ace. And he has become more popular now than he was in 1917 and 1918. Sorry about that. I figured if this thing was dragging a bit, this might work to humor everybody up. But there he is. OK. Tanks. The British are over here, and the Germans are over here, right? Trenches, and in between is no man's land. It's full of mud, it's full of craters, it's full of barbed wire, it's zeroed in by artillery, and it probably has a bunch of machine gun nests in it. It is not a hospitable place. And since you can't, on the Western Front, outmaneuver anybody, because the line extends all the way from Switzerland to the Channel, the only way you can deal with your enemy is to attack straight across no man's land, which, if the enemy has machine guns, which they do, is not a healthy endeavor. So the British say, all right, there's got to be a better way. And they say, why don't we build a machine that can move across no man's land? We'll armor it so rifle bullets will bounce off. We'll make the treads and the tracks in such a way that you can go down a crater and up again, okay? We'll put a gun or two in it so it can take out enemy infantry that we come across or enemy machine gun nests. And we'll, there's the gun, by the way. We'll advance across no man's land with these devices. And to make sure that the Germans don't know what we're doing and are surprised by it, we will call them tanks. And the Germans, if they learn that the Brits have just brought 40 tanks to the front, will say, oh, okay, they're fine, they're filled with water, it's no big deal, right? So that's again, I'm not making this up. That's how that's how they became called tanks. And they were initially slow and unreliable, but by 1918, by the middle of 1918, they started to make a difference. A lot of people know that the machine gun, you know, came of age. And again, if you and your buddies are walking across no man's land, and there's a German machine gun up there, you're probably in big trouble. But the weapon of the First World War was not the machine gun, and it wasn't the rifle, wasn't the grenade, it was artillery. World War I was, to a significant degree, a war of artillery. And both sides became very proficient at it. Very, very proficient at it. I think this is just a marvelous image because it, to me, conveys the technology and the ironness of, that's not a very good word, of all of this thing. Those are 8-inch howitzers, okay? It's the British Army in the Battle of the Somme, one of the few days when there wasn't any mud. Ha-ha. John Singer Sargent. Why is there a picture of three images of John Singer Sargent in World War I? Well, for two reasons. Where's my buddy Craig? Hey, Craig, I took art history too, okay? And, you know, Kurt, I didn't just take political science courses. And the middle image, which is really a great painting, is at the Clark, as you probably all know. Well, it turns out that in 1918, John Singer Sargent was 62 years old, and he went to the Western Front, and he painted one of the great paintings of the First World War. There are in this painting, I sat down, and it's at the National it's the National Gallery in London. I counted 43 individuals in this painting. And they are soldiers who've been gassed, because many of them have bandages around their eyes and can't see. And so they are in line waiting to be treated medically. And one of the iconic images, photographs, of the First World War shows what Sargent saw when he went to the Western Front and why he may have painted this painting. Not fun. Women. The First World War, what I call the Great War, it was the Great War until a second one came along. But, you know, all during the 20s, it was known as the Great War. It was a war not just of armies. It was a war of nations. Nations went to war. The national economies became wartime economies. Everything was focused on producing more, training more, killing more of the enemy. They were national efforts. And women played an extraordinarily important part. Remember, this is the time, in Britain at least, where the suffragettes are starting to make serious noise. Okay? And women had a number of key tasks and occupations. They drove trucks. They were at train stations. They were, of course, nurses. In 1917 and 1918, there were 947,000 people working in the munitions industries in Britain. 90% of them were women. And those of you who remember upstairs, downstairs, will remember that in the later episodes, one of the kitchen girls downstairs leaves the employment and goes off and works in a munition factory. This young woman is making a gas mask, and women were thought to be and may well be more dexterous and careful. So they were making gas masks. Mud. There was just a lot of it in the Western Front. And in Flanders, where the British and the Germans went at each other for 4.5 years, the water table was 2 feet below the surface. So you had trouble digging trenches that remained dry. In fact, you couldn't. Mud brought rats, lice. People would get wounded in no man's land, fall in a crater full of water, and drown to death. It was just awful. So in 1917, things continue, but they also change. Caporetto is a town in northern Italy. The Italians throughout the First World War, the Great War, showed great tenacity and great courage in battling the Austrians. Not always successful, not because of the individual Italian, but because the generals weren't up to the task. But at Caporetto, they suffer a massive defeat, and 275,000 Italians were taken prisoner. The defeat was so great that the French and the British were worried about it. So there was a conference, and eventually, not immediately, but eventually in a series of stages, by 1918, it led to a supreme Allied commander. You have the British and the French, and they talk to each other. They occasionally coordinate. Those of you who worked for the government know the verb coordinate, right? But they did not act as a single unit. And the disaster at Caporetto gets them thinking that, gee, things along the Western Front might be a little better for us if there was a single Allied commander. And so, in 1918, there becomes one, and he's a Frenchman. And he commands, he doesn't suggest, although, in fact, when he issued his orders, he suggested, but he commands the three Allied armies. The British under Field Marshal Sir Douglas Haig, the French under Philippe Pétain, and the Americans under Pershing. He becomes what Eisenhower was in the Second World War, supreme Allied commander. 1917, by now the Russians are in tough shape, and they've lost a massive amount of men. The home front is, in the best of times, is lousy, and it is not even the best of times for sure. There is, of course, a revolution. The Romanovs get thrown out. Vladimir Lenin and the Bolsheviks come to power. Joyce and I were in Moscow, I guess 2 years ago, and we saw Comrade Lenin. And I must say, for someone who died in 1924, he looked pretty good. He had a white shirt and a tie. It was nice music, etc. So the Bolsheviks take over, and the Russians go out of the war. And the British and the French understandably get very nervous because now the full front of the German army can be devoted to the West. But by the end of 1916, the Germans know that they are losing the battle of attrition. And if things keep going as they're going, they will lose. So they return to a form of warfare that they had used before but stopped, and that is unrestricted submarine warfare. Britain's an island. If you sink every damn ship that goes to and from Great Britain, they will have no food. They will have no petroleum, and they won't have any oil, and the whole thing will just come to a grinding halt. So if you want to throw Britain out of the war, sink every ship that's sailing to and from the island, unrestricted submarine warfare. So the Germans take a gamble. And the gamble is they know that once they decide to do that, the Americans will come into the war. But they figure, not unreasonably, that they can sink enough ships, defeat Britain before the impact of the Americans is realized. And it's a gamble. And it comes that close to happening. Submarines become, along with planes and tanks, a very sophisticated device of warfare during the First World War. This is actually, just because I kind of think it's a cool picture, this is actually a British submarine, but no, same idea. So on February, unrestricted submarine warfare is initiated. And just as everyone expected, the Americans declare war. And there is President Wilson seeking and receiving a declaration of war against Germany. So what do the Americans do? Well, they go off to France in huge numbers. In huge numbers. The problem is that they are untrained and under-equipped. And they, but boy, there are a whole bunch of them. And they're eager to fight. These are kids from Iowa and Maryland and Georgia and Vermont and Texas. They're raring to go. They have no idea what the hell they're doing, but they're raring to go. And there are six battles in which the Americans fight. The last two are big battles. The upper ones are small ones. I thought there were also six American combat artists in 1917 and 1918, guys who were commissioned in the Army to draw. And this is just one of their sketches. And I think it's the Americans were brave, eager, poorly led, and under-equipped. I thought Barbara LeRoy was going to be here, so I included this next slide, because that's the Marines at Belleau Wood. And this is the memorial statue to the Marines in Belleau Wood. And one of the great traditions of the Corps takes place at Belleau Wood, and they come marching across the field of poppies, which you cannot see in this painting, but trust me, they're there and they're red. And it's an epic chapter in the history of the United States Marine Corps. But the biggest battle of the Americans was at the Meuse-Argonne, as part of the final push. And there the American Army's inexperience shows. It is successful, but 26,000 Americans are killed. Okay, this is a battle that most of us don't know anything about. Most of us have never heard about it. It is the major engagement of the American Army in the First World War. It lasts 47 days. It is ultimately successful. It's in the Meuse-Argonne, forested area, lousy place to fight. The American Army staff structure isn't up to the task because it's brand new, inexperienced. The American Army hasn't moved large amount of troops since 1865. So it's not ready for the kind of mass warfare that it's engaged in. This is the cemetery, the American military cemetery. Casualties numbered 95,000. It took 47 days, and 26,000 Americans were killed. It was a very big deal. So it's now March 1918, and the Germans are really worried because things aren't going swimmingly. And they say, all right, we're going to have one last, I'm almost finished, by the way. We're going to have one last push. And we're going to secretly bring a couple armies together, and we're going to have well-trained stormtroopers, and we're going to attack a British army, crush it, separate it from the French, roll it up, push it into the channel. The amazing thing is that in December of 1944, they try the same thing in the Battle of the Bulge. But this is 1918. They attack, they crush a British army. They take 21,000 prisoners on day one, and they push the British army back 40 miles, which was an unheard of territorial advance. The problem is, just like at Jutland, nothing changed. Okay, the British army's 40 miles back, but the British are still there. The Germans are weaker still because they've had a lot of guys killed. French army is still there, and in the south, the Americans are there. So there are actually five offensives. The first one is in March, the last one is in July. When the last one peters out, Foch says, okay, everybody, we're gonna go get these guys. And many of the generals, British, French, and Americans, thought the war would go on through 1919, and Foch says, I don't think so. Let's do it. And let's attack across all fronts. So the British attack up north, the French attack in the middle, and the Americans, this is the Meuse-Argonne, attack in the south. And the German army falls back and is defeated. And so the German army says, okay, enough. German government says, we want an armistice. Okay? An armistice is just an agreement to stop fighting, right? And Foch and the French, not the British and not the Americans, but the French. Remember, on the Western Front, the battles fought mostly on the French soil. The French lay down the terms, and we all read about them in our history book, and there they are. And so, it comes to an end after 1,568 days. But remember, the German army hasn't surrendered. Okay, next one. 53,000 Americans are killed. That is, of course, terrible. But with respect, it's almost nothing compared to everybody else. And that's a conservative number. French had 1.2 million soldiers killed. The British had 900,000 killed. The Italians had 465,000 killed. The Russians had 1.7 million killed. I mean, it was this just god-awful bloodbath. So there they are, five things to remember about the First World War. But I'm going to add one, and that is German army didn't surrender. There was an armistice, not a surrender. So after November, there's one great story. It's 2 minutes before 11 o'clock on the 11th, and a German soldier on the Western Front has a machine gun, and he fires his machine gun, looks at his watch, he stops, he stands up, he bows, and he walks away. Not yet, go back. Sorry. The German army doesn't surrender, marches home. There's a victory parade in Berlin, except it's for the Germans. It's not American troops, and it's not French troops, and it's not British troops. And so meanwhile, society is imploding. Everybody's hungry and mad. And so people start to think, well, how did this happen? How did we lose the war if the army wasn't defeated? Well, it must have been those damn communists. It must have been those damn socialists. And it must have been the Jews. That's why. And so that's the origin of the stab in the back theory. Now, this talk of mine is actually a summary of five lectures that are similar to this. And in the process, I looked at a whole bunch of photographs of the First World War. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of them. And many of them are iconic. But the next one, which you've seen, is my favorite photograph. It's just three guys, okay? Like us, like we used to be before we became 72. Just three guys. They're either British, Canadian, or American, okay? It's wintertime, because they got scarves on. I can tell that they're British, French, or Canadian because of the helmet. They're infantrymen, because they each have rifles. But they're at rest because the rifles are muzzled, right? They're just eating. They're just three guys. And to me, this, I've long wondered what he's eating. They're just three guys who probably got caught up in something they'd rather not have been. Hopefully they survived. But every one of the 8.1 million soldiers who died, and remember, they died in the mud, they died in the desert. They died at sea, they died under the sea, they died in the air, they died in the mountains. Every one of them was a human being like you and me. And thus, the war which shaped the 20th century. German imperial state went away, giving us the Weimar Republic, oh boy. The Romanovs went away, giving us the Bolsheviks. Oh boy, wasn't that great, right? The Austro-Hungarians went away and nobody really cared or noticed, right? And the Ottomans went away. Britain is financially ruined. The French have 630,000 widows who are not going to produce children because their man, either their husband or their husband-to-be, is dead at Verdun or somewhere else. And the Americans come prancing in at the end saying, hi, we're here. We're going to win it for you. It was this awful, awful event, but it shaped the 20th century, the century that we lived through. And again, every one of them who died, just poor some guy, just trying to make a living, trying to make a life, doing what he can. Thank you.